Welcome to another edition of The Christ Life. We're so glad that you joined us today as we have been looking at this series of messages that Jesus is alive, active, and available. And it really focuses in on the first chapter of the book of Acts, where we get a little bit of insight in between Jesus's resurrection and then ultimately his ascension. And I want to pick it up as we're moving towards Pentecost. And I believe that you'll even see today, even more than ever before, that Jesus really is preparing his disciples, preparing his followers to live a life that is really proving that he is alive and active and available. So let's pick it up in Acts chapter 1, starting in verse 3. It says, he presented himself alive to them after his suffering by many proofs, appearing to them during 40 days and speaking about the kingdom of God. And while staying with them, he ordered them not to depart from Jerusalem, but to wait for the promise of the Father, which he said, you have heard from me, for John baptized with water, but you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days from now. In Dresden, Germany, there in the middle of the Royal Mews, there's actually this beautiful 394-foot the mural that has been done of all the princes of and all the rulers of Saxony history. And the cool thing is that Dresden in World War II was actually obliterated by the Western forces. And yet this wall remained. It actually was originally done in 1876. And it was actually etched into the stucco. But then they came later. And when I actually saw it, it was actually had been redone and recast into porcelain tiles. Now, here's the thing. As I looked at that mural and I saw all the different princes and kings and monarchs of the history of that area of the world, I didn't know any of them by name. I couldn't tell you one thing that they actually did in this world to leave a mark, change, any of that kind of stuff. Yet, because of the love for the rulers, they made this mural. Now, what makes Jesus different, unlike the people on the mural, is that Jesus is not dead. He's alive. He is still actively growing his kingdom. He's still actively bringing people into the family of God. He is actively going into the gates of hell and pulling people who are headed toward eternal destruction. He's pulling them into his life. And so for us, as we kind of explore this, Jesus spent time with his disciples, proving that he wasn't going to just end up on a mural, that he wasn't going to be a picture in somebody's living room, but that he is alive and active. And he was going to continue to show his activity, to show his love, to show his compassion, to show his mercy through his followers. And he understood completely that his followers were going to be unable to do that on their own. They weren't going to be able to prove that Jesus is alive and active and available by showing his love, by showing his character, by demonstrating his power without being equipped with the power of the Holy Spirit. And so Jesus, he tells them, I want you to go and wait for the baptism, for the empowerment that is going to be from on high, the power of the Holy Spirit. And ultimately, this is the essence of the Christ life. It is proving that Jesus is alive and active in the world today, and we're proving it through the love that we've received from him. Now, as we begin to make the connection between advancing the kingdom, the proving that Jesus is alive and active and available, and the Pentecost or the baptism in the Holy Spirit, I really want you to get this point today, that love is a better way into the Pentecostal empowerment. Love is a better way into that Pentecostal empowerment. Because of all the weirdness of history, because of all the different things that people have done that have made the baptism in the Holy Spirit weird, or they have intellectually kind of taken it away, I want you to understand that it's the love that ultimately is empowered by God's Spirit to prove that Jesus is alive and active in the world today. As Paul really talked about in 1 Corinthians chapter 13, he talked about what love is not, that love is it's It's not something that is rude. It's not something that is keeps records of wrongs. It's not something that's irritable. It's not something that is boastful. And so when you begin to take the people that have used the power of Pentecost as a way to elevate themselves, to make themselves larger than life, as it were, they've diminished and not really shown the kind of love that Christ came to show. Because he showed ultimately the love of the Father. He demonstrated the love of the Father by the way he lived. He demonstrated the love of the Father by the miracles that he performed. He demonstrated the love of the Father just by his character as he interacted with different people. And so Paul, when in 1 Corinthians 13 and 17, he describes real ultimately what Jesus lived out. He lived out the it bears all things. Jesus bared a lot of different things, even being hung on the cross. He believed all things. He believed that his Father was able to get through the issues that confronted people on a day-to-day. He hoped in all things. Ultimately, he knew that the Father would come through, not just for him, but the people that he was ministering to, the people he was demonstrating his love to. And he endured all things. He endured the Roman government. He endured the insults that came. He endured the religious leaders of the day trying to cast him off and throw him to the side. Why? Because he knew that the love that was within him was greater than anything that was in the world. So when you begin to make a connect between this love and the empowerment of Pentecost, you begin to recognize that where chapter 13 of 1 Corinthians is even placed. And of course, this is a chapter that is quoted in weddings throughout. But the key to understanding 1 Corinthians 13 is that it is the language that is ultimately being communicated from 1 Corinthians 12 and 1 Corinthians 14. For the gifts of the Spirit are ultimately intended to demonstrate to a world that is saturated, that is covered in, that is full of hate and discord and backbiting and rudeness and boastfulness and all the things that I mentioned earlier, that now that the gifts have been given, that the love of the Almighty God might be made known so that people can stand up and say, truly, Jesus is alive and active and available. And he's alive, active, and available through Holy Spirit-empowered people who are demonstrating love on a daily basis. In fact, if you look at the end of 1 Corinthians 12, Paul writes these words. He says, but earnestly desire higher gifts, and I will show you a still a more excellent way. And that's his lead in to love. That's his lead in to this explanation of how we are to demonstrate love to a world that is really filled with and very well aware of what the opposite hate is. So love, again, I want to bring you back to this point. Love is a better way in to Pentecost. This statement I'm going to say is probably, if you've been a follower of Jesus not long, you've heard it, and maybe you've pondered it and you've struggled with it and you've kind of tried to figure out what it is. And I want to bring some clarity when I say that God has a plan for your life. And it doesn't matter if you are in the Dallas-Fort Worth area. It doesn't matter if you're an American or you're African or you're Russian or you're a Brazilian or you're Chinese. The plan that God has for you and I is exactly the same. And it's simply that the love of Christ is demonstrated on a daily basis, everywhere we go, with everyone we meet, so that they may truly know that Jesus is alive and active in the world today. But here's the thing. Jesus knew that this was not something that we could just have a mental assent to. We can't just decide one day that we're going to love. He understood that it would require the Holy Spirit to help us love those who are even our enemies. Because you know as well as I do, life proves it time and time again, it is easy to love those who love you. But Jesus called us to love our enemies. And to love your enemies, it requires the empowerment of his Spirit to help us accomplish that very thing. So I want to talk just for a couple minutes really about the source, the force, and the course of love. Now, the source of love is simply our connectivity with that source. It's the source being the God Almighty. And the connectivity to the Father of Heaven is a prerequisite for love. Now, I know there are people, I've heard it over the years, well, there are a lot of people who don't follow Jesus and they love. Well, they do love. And of course, there is a certain, there's certainly a romanticized love that a lot of people live in. But there are characteristics to marriage that ultimately you don't need to be a Christian to actually invoke the principles of Christ-like love. But it's one thing to love those you know. It's one thing to love those who love you. But what about the person that absolutely drives you crazy? What about the person that is your enemy? In order to love that person, now you must be connected to a source. And I think about it a little bit this way. Our little smartphones, our devices that we use every day, they can run on their own power, the power source that's in them for a while. But the reality is it's not going to be long, depending on how good the battery is, that you're going to have to reconnect to the source. In fact, one of the things that I chuckle about every time I travel and I go to the airport, I see groups of people huddled around little tables that have the plug-ins because they didn't realize that they were going to fly and they were going to need their battery to last the 2, 3, 4, 5 hours they were going to be on a plane. So they were connecting to a source so they could be prepared to have their electronic devices last on an airplane. Here's the thing. I think there are people that are woefully underprepared to move into relationships where the love of the Almighty God is going to not only sustain them, but allow them to minister to and to show the love of Christ to people that are around them. So our regular connectivity to the Lord is critical. In fact, 1 John says it this way, God is love and whoever abides in love, now there's the connectivity, abides in love, abides in God, and God abides in him. We have to be connected to the power and the person being Jesus in order to love unconditionally. Now, let me take just a moment and talk to you a little bit how that works. It means that you and I have to decide to disconnect, to push away the things that easily overtake our everyday life. And we have to give space of time where we are before our God, receiving and talking to him about the things that are in our life. So I believe that having time where you can take God's word, where I'm a big electronics guy, I open the word electronically so I can put my notes in my iPad at the same time. And I begin to read God's word. But as one who's already been filled with the Spirit and believe that praying in tongues, it builds me up, it empowers me, it fills me more with God's love, I begin to pray as I read. So as I read over John chapter 15, and I read about the vine and being in him, I talk to the Lord about really showing the fruit of love to people who are in my life, the people that I interact with that I find it difficult to love. I say, Lord, you're the source, so would you bring that kind of love in my life? And what I find is he begins to fill me with the love that is required to demonstrate the Christ kind of love that makes me different than the other people that are in their life. That's the source of love. The force of love is always an action. It's gonna move us. It's gonna compel us to connect with people. I'm a big believer in connecting with people because I never know where Jesus Christ was gonna wanna connect his love through me to them. And so putting myself in a place where I am not isolated, where I am not set apart from everyone else, but where I can connect with people in such a way that I can care for and minister to them. Now, there are times where I know I'm going into a situation, I'm going into an area of my life where I'm going to be around more people who are, or you know how it is. There are days where you're kind of on your last nerve and you get around people who they're going to step on it. They're going to take and squeeze that last nerve. Well, in those moments, I've got to spend time and say, okay, Lord, will you help me to recognize how you want to minister through me to them today? A lot of the times it really is just born out of a day-to-day relationship with the Lord where I am connecting with him. This is a place where there are some people, they struggle with forgiveness, that someone has harmed you or hurt you when you were a child, or they've harmed you in the body of Christ, or they've harmed you in the workplace, and you've been unable to release that. You get connected to the source again. The force that begins to move there is that forgiveness begins to happen in your life. There's a beautiful story about a man by the name of Louis Zamperini. Louis Zamperini was an Olympic athlete. He was a runner, and then he became an Air Force pilot during World War II. And he was shot by the Japanese over the Pacific, and him and two other gentlemen were in life rafts and thought they were going to starve in life rafts. And it was in this moment that he looked to heaven and he said, God, if you will save me from this, I'll give my life to you. And no one's spirituality, including his, is a straight line. And so it wasn't as simple as now. He just became this connected to the source and the force. And what happened was, is he was rescued, but he was rescued by the Japanese. And he was taken to one of the Japanese camps where he was abused and tortured day after day after day. Well, of course, the end of the war came and he was released. But the force of the love, because of his connectivity with the Lord that continued to grow, caused him to go back and forgive every Japanese soldier who had hurt or harmed him during his time with them. In fact, there is one particular Japanese soldier who would not meet with him. So he wrote him a letter. And it's a beautiful story of how the force of love, when you're connected to the source, ultimately allows you to move in a way that confuses the world. In fact, in 1998, he was the torchbearer of the Winter Olympics that year. But let me tell you something. While some would say, boy, that would just be the height of life. For him, I guarantee you, the highlight is when he stands before his heavenly Father and he says, well done, good and faithful servant. Enter into the joy of your salvation because you carried the light of my love to let the world know in horrific situations that I am alive and I am active and I am available today. So proving that Jesus is not dead. Then there's the course of it. And the course of it isn't as simple as an A, B, or C, because when you begin to live a spirit-led life where you are pliable in the direction that you go, you're not rigid. But a big part of that course is, as I mentioned earlier, you begin to connect with people. But you don't just connect with them. You connect with them knowing that you're connecting with Jesus. But I want you to hear this principle when it comes to the course. And I would pray that you, if you are adopting a Christ life, you're saying, I want that kind of lifestyle, that you understand this principle, that you live with passion, but you move with compassion. You live with passion, but you move with compassion. Passion just has to do with speaking the truth in love, not being afraid of looking at someone and with all love and all sincerity, not out of bitterness, not out of hate, not out of divisiveness, but saying a life that does not receive Jesus Christ, a life that does not step into Jesus's life is doomed to a life, to an eternity apart from God, an eternity of hell. And I don't want to see you go that way. See, we've been scared into believing that we're not supposed to talk like that, but love always warns a person about the dangers that are before them. And what you find is that it begins to drive you daily. You begin to look for opportunities to serve people that are around you. You're not doing it because you're working for God. Oh, heaven forbid. There is no joy in that whatsoever. But when you really are connected to the source of love and now you're moving by the force of love, the course will move you towards feeding the poor. It will move you towards giving to those who have nothing. It'll move you towards sending someone a text, letting them know that you're praying for them. It'll cause you to begin to care for those that are around you. That is living with passion. But I want you to move with passion, with compassion. And here's the difference. Compassion is something that you literally feel on the inside. Jesus, you'll find in scripture that he moved with compassion. There was something that he felt. He felt a stirring of the spirit in his belly. Rex isn't with us again this week, but this is how he says it. He says that you feel a whoosh. And when you feel that whoosh, don't ignore that. Don't act like that's nothing. And don't spend long going, was that me or the Lord? The Lord gives you this physical sign to step into a moment. Now watch this, where the miraculous can take place. Where you read in Acts that he spent many sufferings proving that he was the Christ. And there are people that you know, there are people that I know, that the only way that they're going to believe that Jesus Christ is alive and active and available is if the miraculous takes place. And there is nothing more joyous than to be able to share the gospel after God has done something miraculous in someone's life. Because they can argue with you theologically all day, but they can't argue the miraculous. So when you feel that whoosh come, step into that moment. In fact, I remember a number of years ago, I had not been a Christian long, and I didn't actually know what was taking place, but I wanted to always move with this love and compassion. So I was always looking for opportunities to serve. And I only did it one time, but I went as a kid's camp counselor. And I was way too old for doing that for my energy level. But the thing was, is as one of the services were winding down, I'm praying. And as I'm standing back and the kids have all gone up to the altar for prayer, I began to ask the Lord, what is it that you want? And I felt an incredible compassion for one of the young boys that we had brought. He wasn't the only one that we brought that we ministered to because of a van ministry that was part of our church. But the Lord said, I want you to go and I want you just to speak how I love him. And as I began to go up there, I started to try to formulate the right words. And then I kind of just went, wait a minute, Jesus said, just to tell him that I love him. And I told the young man that I loved him. That the Lord loved him and that the Lord has always loved him and will always love him. And then I felt I was done. And I stepped back and then I had this moment that for you might struggle to believe, but for me, it was something that I experienced. The Lord said, now watch what I will do. And I saw a silhouette of an angel over this young man that the angel had this vase and he would take the vase and he would begin to pour it over this boy's head. And I could see every time that the angel did this, there was a shaking that went all the way down, physically shaking all the way down that boy. God did something miraculous because I moved based on a compassion that he had placed in my heart. So I want to encourage you, when it comes to the course of love, live with passion, but move with compassion. And so as we move towards the Pentecost, I want to encourage you to make a decision to go to the Lord as the source so that he might fill you, so that the force of his love might be not just known in you, but be made known through you because you've stepped into the course of love. And so we're praying and believing that as we get to Pentecost, that you will, even in the privacy of your home, you will just turn your hands toward heaven and you would say, Father, Will you fill me with the love of your spirit today? Will you fill me with your love of your spirit every day? And then I'd like you to just leave with this. We would love to hear your stories of God's love being expressed through you. Would you take a moment and would you just send us, whether it's down in the comments or by email, would you let us know how the force of God's love is being made known in the course of your life? God bless you and thank you for being a part and partnering in the Christ life.
We hope that this video has blessed you. If it has, will you hit the subscribe button below or the like button? You could also share it with your friends, or you could put a prayer request up on our prayer wall. As always, have a blessed week, and we hope to see you soon.